a hidden truth. It is said that dreams are manifestations of our thoughts. In fact, it is repeated mulling that reflects such deep-seated meditation. Sankalpa Seva to Sri Raghavendra and worship of him with undisturbed concentration could cause enlightenment on the solution to problems engrossing one's mind. Such enlightenments may be in the nature of symbolic revelations, perceivable only by the subject concerned. For the seva done at Bidrahalli, Bharti Boy alone among the couple had a dream in which Sri Guru Raja appeared before her. And in the dream, Sri Guru Raja had not only indicated to her that her desire would get fulfilled, but offered also Mantrakshata to her, which she tied in a knot in her sari. In the morning, to her great surprise, there really was some Mantrakshata tied in a knot at the end of her sari, a thing that she had only received in her dream. And what an awe-inspiring experience it would have been for Bharti Bai, when even we feel her revelations as we come to know about it. Perhaps Sri Raghavendra could have really appeared in person before Bharti Bai early in the morning and proffered the sacred rice to her, when her mind could have been in deep concentration on the Guru and she could have felt a sort of repose in between, like a kind of drowsiness. And truly, what kind of a linkage existed between Sri Raghavendra's Mantrakshata and Bidrahalli is unveiled in this episode as well. It was mentioned earlier that Madhvacharya had seen another object also along with the Mantrakshata and had wondered about it. And that what it was will be unfolded in the narratives that follow. Madhvacharya and Bharti, after completion of the seva, returned to their place with utmost contentment. The couple, as was their wont, were doing puja every day to Sri Raghavendra Mrittika Brindavana along with other vigrahas. As a result of their rigorous seva and the grace of Sri Harivayu Guru, Bharti Bai Erlock was in the family way. People in the village felt joyous that by the grace of Sri Raghavendra, Bharti Bai would soon become a mother. And on an auspicious day, Bharti Bai gave birth to a son, the child looking extremely attractive and lovely. Look, Bharti, Sri Raghavendra, even on that day, had given us the hint that a son would be born to us. Has not my surmise come true? There was another object along with Pala Mantrakshata, which Sri Raghavendra had proffered to Bharti Bai in her dream. Yes, it was the Angara about which we had seen earlier in the chapter on Gopi Chandana. Sri Raghavendra, in answer to the prayers of the couple for a prodigious son to be born to them, had symbolically given Bharti Bai and Angara along with Mantrakshata, assertive of such a grace by him. The child born thus with the grace of Sri Raghavendra was named as Raghavendra and brought up with great affection. The entire neighborhood wondered at the radiance in the face of the child, and it was evident even in its infancy that it was not an ordinary child, but an exceptional one. As the child grew up, his father himself as guru taught him Vedic knowledge. And when he was 5, the father could make out that his son was not exhibiting any interest in mingling and playing with children of that age, but was always lost in thought, as if he had missed something. On very few occasions, he would, however, spend some time playing with his younger sister. Yes, after Raghavendra's birth, the couple had a girl child too, and the father felt the consolation that his son was at least exhibiting some kind of affection towards his sister. Child Raghavendra had the capacity to grasp whatever he had learnt once. He was ever obedient to his parents and was hospitable towards those calling at his house, showing utmost respect to elders. Despite being endowed with such enviable virtues, he was found to be detached from the normal way of life, much to the consternation of his father. One day, the progenitor called his son aside and, caressing him affectionately, vented to him, "Raghavendra, your mother and I are really proud to be your parents. You are the gift of Sri Hari, a prasad of the Guru. But unlike children of your age, you are always engrossed in deep thinking, exhibiting signs of disquiet. Father, what for have I taken this birth? Where have I come from? When can I have liberation from this birth? And whom should I approach for that?" Such questions and the query as to whom I should surrender to are always occupying my mind, and therefore I am unable to live like a normal boy. Madhvacharya, on hearing those words, was taken aback and stood up from his seat. "Are you the one in quest about the answers for these? On the other hand, you should be the one to answer these," reflected the father and told his son, "Raghavendra, though your thinking is beyond your age, you are also of a level of intelligence that is far beyond your age. So it is not me who should be providing you the answers to your questions. You yourself will realize in due course who it would be. Presently, you should leave aside such thoughts and divert your mind to the routine way of life." The boy, in deference to the counsel of his parent, prostrated before him in obeisance and got up. Madhvacharya, outweighed by the conduct of the boy, told his wife, "Though born as our son, he does not certainly belong to us. He is going to leave us, and on my part, I should, as a father, be fulfilling whatever is required of me, well, in time, as my duty." Bharati Bai, on hearing those words, asked her husband with great concern, "What are you telling, Swami?" To which he wriggled out, saying, "We have to do his Upanayana, is it not? That's what I meant." At 6, the boy's Upanayana was duly performed by the parents, and since the Brahmopadesha was over, the father started teaching him Granthas. But for child Raghavendra, even the most difficult one was easy to learn, and he was able to grasp the meanings of even difficult concepts and raise questions about them. He was also adept at explaining the things absorbed by him. When he was 13, his father started teaching him Nyaya Sudha. Sri Raghavendra Swami earned the honorific Parimalacharya for the brilliant exposition he had proffered on that tough writing, which became famed as Suddha Parimala. Child Raghavendra learnt such complex work as the Nyaya Sudha with great ease, even at that young age. During those times, child marriage was the order of the day, and it was believed that such wedlock would efface all evil influences. Bharati Bai was, however, intent on having her son married off early for the reason that she was having apprehensions about his future life. Since Raghavendra was extraordinarily brilliant, parents of girls vied with each other in proposing their daughters for wedlock with such an acceptable bridegroom. Perhaps if they had foreknowledge of his future, they would not have come forward to seek his hand. Yes, what his future life could have been can to some extent be surmised by the readers at this stage itself. But even beyond such expectations, several wondrous things had indeed taken place. Sri Satyabodha Tita of the Uttaradi Math was once camping at Savanur. In part 5, we have seen about Sri Satyavijaya, in whose memory Satyavijaya Nagaram near Arni in Tamil Nadu was established, and where Sri Raghavendra Mrittika Vrindavana came to be installed and consecrated later. For a perplexity in the mind of Sri Satyapriya, Sri Anjaneya, who had been consecrated at the outskirt of the town by Sri Vyasaraja, had taken his gigantic form and appeared before Sri Satyapriya and enlightened him about the matter, which episode also finds description at the same place in part 5. Sri Satyapriya, who has figured in that incident, entered his Vrindavana at Manamadurai in Tamil Nadu much later. Sri Satyabodha, mentioned earlier, was the disciple of Sri Satyapriya. Madhvacharya, on knowing about the presence of Sri Satyabodha at Savanur, wanted to take his son there and broached the proposal with his wife. Bharti, the Swami is at Savanur. Shall we go there to get his blessings? You both could go there, Swami. Our daughter can remain here with me, said Bharti boy haltingly. Why are you hesitant to see the Swami, Bharti? Something is preventing me, Swami. I am unable to explain that. I am desirous of getting Raghavendra married off early. Please get the pontiff's blessings for that, Swami, Madhvacharya said. All right, I shall do that, and left for Savanur with his son. Bharti Bai had a special attachment towards her son, as he was born with divine grace after 22 years and was excelling in Vedic knowledge. Don't stay there long. Please return at once, as there may not be timely food in the Srimat, and our son may not be able to bear with such difficulties, Bharti Bai repeatedly told her husband as parting words. Sri Satyabodha was imparting knowledge to his disciples when Madhvacharya reached there with his son. Most of those lending their ears to the Swami's teachings were between 60 and 70 years of age. But Raghavendra was already familiar with all those lessons. He was well versed in those, even at the age of 13. The father and son prostrated in front of the Swami from a distance and sat there. After the tuition was over, Sri Satyabodha called Madhvacharya and asked, "What is the boy learning?" And when Madhvacharya informed what all the boy had been taught, the Swami asked Raghavendra a question relating to what he had learned. And Raghavendra gave the reply for nearly an hour, much to the surprise of all those present there. To another question too, Raghavendra gave detailed explanation, and the gathering there could not even know how much time had passed, being so much absorbed in what the young boy was explaining. Virtually a torrent flowing out of his mouth. Sri Satyabodha, much impressed with the wide knowledge of Raghavendra, patted him in appreciation and blessed him. He then asked Madhvacharya whether he would be in a position to stay in the mat for a couple of days. Madhvacharya told the Swami most humbly, "It's a blessing and a rare privilege, Swami." The Samsthana Puja was over later, followed by Teerth Prasad. In the afternoon, Madhvacharya met the Swami in his private confines. "What, Madhvarya, Madhvaraya, do you have some doubt or is it some submission you have to make? Raghavendra's marriage has to be performed. His mother is very eager to have it celebrated early. I am seeking Swami's blessings for that with Mantrakshata. Let it happen so. But there is no urgency for it, I reckon. Raghavendra can be left in the mat and you may return to your place," said the Swami, which immediately brought to Madhvacharya's mind what his wife Bharti Bai had repeatedly told him before his departure to Savanur. But not being in a position to say no to Swami's advice, Madhvacharya managed to tell, "It's all right, Swami. I shall be here for 2 days and then return to my place," taking leave of Swami from his presence. Later, when Madhvacharya reached his place, Bharatibai became concerned about Raghavendra not returning from with his father. And when she heard about what all had taken place at the streamer, she burst into uncontrollable grief. He has acquired immense Vedic knowledge from your tutoring and was excelling in his studies. Oh, how can I remain without him? You have not paid heed to my repeated exhortations and have left him at the monastery. Is this justifiable in any manner? Look, Bharati, don't you have a daughter? Be happy in her company. Our son will shine like a polished diamond, and as parents we should feel proud of his excellence. You're telling something only to console me, Bharatibai said, realizing that she could do nothing about it, being aware that the pontiff of the Srimad may not condescend to her son leaving the Srimad. She then reconciled herself with the hope that at least she could be visiting the Srimad often to see her son. Sri Satyabodha Tita gave the name Ramachandra to the young entrant Raghavendra and started teaching him advanced Vedic lessons. It was Lord Ramachandra who had enlightened Sri Sudhindra Tita to give the holy name Raghavendra to Venkatanatha. And it is but befitting that for Raghavendra, born with the blessings of the same Sri Raghavendra Swami, Sri Satyabodha Tita should have given the holy name Ramachandra. Madhvacharya visited the Srimad often with his family to see his son, and that way 3 years had passed. At that stage, Bharatibai prevailed over her husband to broach her son's matrimony to the pontiff. Accordingly, Madhvacharya submitted to the pontiff. Swami, my wife is worried about our son still continuing single. Have you seen acceptable brides for him? Bharatibai hurriedly intervened. Yes, Swami, there are many willing to propose their daughters. Is it so? In that case, can you finalize the marriage for your son with the bride that I would be suggesting? If His Holiness Himself should be showing the way for us, what else can we crave for, Swami? Submitted Madhvacharya. The pontiff, casting his glance instantly at his divan, Seturamachar asked him, are you willing to offer your daughter in marriage to his son? Pointing to Madhvacharya. On hearing that, the divan became ecstatic and tongue-tied. Divan Seturamachar was the Purvashrama son of Sri Satyabodha, and Bharatibai too was the Purvashrama younger sister of Sri Satyabodha. The marriage proposal was thus the one between the pontiff's Purvashrama sister's son and the daughter of his Purvashrama son. Later, on an auspicious day, the marriage of the 18-year-old Ramachandra with the 13-year-old Lakshmibai took place to the great joy of Bharatibai. The proud mother then returned to her place with her son and daughter-in-law in a ceremonial ambience. Sri Satyabodha afterwards started on his religious tour. Ramachandra was now and then going to the Srimad and joining in the Swami's yatras and returning home on completion of the religious tour. When Ramachandra was 22, he became the father of a son, and in the following year, a daughter too was born to him. While so, Ramachandra became terribly alarmed one day when he heard that some evil-minded ones had mixed poison in the food of Sri Satyabodha Tita and it was spreading in his system. Since it was opined by the physicians, the poisonous effect permeating in his body could be checked if the Swami could avoid sleeping at night, the pontiff held Vedic classes for his disciples, indulged in puja and followed the routine ritual of Tirtha Prasad. It unfortunately evoked the derision in certain quarters as to how the Swami could take food after sunset. Ramachandra, stung by these uncharitable whispers, took the initiative of politely apprising the Swami of what some people were murmuring. On the following day, the Swami called the public of the place to the streamer and at midnight caused the sun to be seen by everyone present there, transforming night into day. In consequence, it dawned on the antagonists that even if the Swami had consumed food at night, it was daytime for him by his reckoning. After this incident, Sri Satyabodha's thought turned in a different direction, and Ramachandra, without knowing the change in the perception of the Swami, was visiting the Srimad in the routine way that he was accustomed to. Readers may be hazarding a guess at this stage that Sri Satyabodha would have advised Ramachandra to take to Sannyasa Ashrama. Yes, the Swami did entertain such a desire and asked Ramachandra his consent for it. But contrary to his expectation, the Swami had to encounter something shocking which he could not share with others and had to keep the agony arising therefrom to himself. In fact, the Pitadhipati literally wept before Sri Digvijaya Rama as the enlightenment that had flashed in his mind was not to be known to others.